Thank you. Thank you. And good morning to you all. Yes. Hi, I'm John Burt. I'm CEO of Abzena. We've got a simple business. We provide services to the pharmaceutical industry, the biotechnology community, to enable the development of the better biopharmaceuticals of the future. So service business where we apply our proprietary technologies with that mission to enable better biopharmaceuticals. We do that by improving the products they're developing. We do that by de-risking the development process for them and then manufacturing those products as they move forward into clinical development. We operate in the biopharmaceutical market, by which I mean we primarily focus on biological products, antibodies, protein therapeutics. We're a service business. We provide those services to enable the development of better biopharmaceuticals. But we also have our own proprietary technologies, which we embed into our partners' programs where appropriate, and it gives us an economic interest in those products as they go forward into development. So we're generating revenues today from the services we provide, the services we provide, which range through preclinical development into manufacturing, and what we call the Abzena Inside concept, with apologies to Intel, it's the Abzena Inside concept, where we've embedded our technologies in those products, we've got an economic interest, we've got an intellectual property interest in those products, and that gives us significant future license income potential across a portfolio of products from a portfolio of licenses. Within that Abzena Inside license portfolio, we've got partner products which are moving through development, being funded by our partners. We're not funding the development. We've provided the technologies, we provide the services, our partners are funding that development. We're not a development company. Our partners are developing. We've enabled them with the tools to develop their products. There are 11 products in clinical development already that we've enabled, and I'll come on to those in more detail later. And there are three product companies that took products that we developed, initiated, and they've been acquired by major pharma companies in deals, three companies, deals worth $1.5 billion. So major pharma companies see the value of products which have been enabled with our technologies, and they're paying significant sums to buy those companies. Really, even those companies are focused on products that we've enabled. And more recently, we've concluded a license deal with a major US biotech company for our antibody drug conjugate linker technology. I'll come back to that again in more detail. But that has the potential to deliver us $150 million of milestone revenues and royalties on the sales of those products going forward. So think of us today as an integrated business with revenues from the services and a very significant potential to generate license revenues in the future. Sometimes I say it's the picks and shovels business, but with a royalty on the gold. With apologies again to Mark Twain. So who are Abzena? Juliet said in the introduction, we're in a global business. Yes, we are. We operate across Europe and US. Our customers are global businesses. We have customers from all corners of the globe. Within the Abzena group, we've built the group through a series of acquisitions. So we have Antitope, Polytherics, Pacific GMP, and TCRS within the group. These are businesses with their own specialisms. We integrate as one in providing those services to our customers. In the UK, those businesses, Antitope focuses on immunology and protein engineering, and Polytherics is a company that was spun out of Imperial College and the School of Pharmacy at UCL based on polymer technologies and bioconjugation expertise. In the autumn, we made two acquisitions in the US, which brought in Pacific GMP and TCRS, which gave us that US presence in San Diego, where we do the manufacturing of the protein and antibody therapeutics to GMP standards, good manufacturing practice standards. And at TCRS, the chemistry research solution business in Philadelphia, we have contract chemistry capabilities with a focus on antibody drug conjugates. As we know, the largest market for pharmaceuticals is in the US. Many of the significant players are in the US. Many of our customers are in the US, and we're now operating in the US with these acquisitions. So we're broadening our service offering. We're increasing the service revenue through that manufacturing capability. Particularly when we're working with emerging biotech companies, we're able to take them through the soup to nuts of the development process through manufacturing to clinical trials. So enabling and holding their hand through that development process to the manufacturing. And clearly there's benefit of being able to cross-sell into our partners and enable their programs to progress. Because you see many emerging biotech companies adopting a virtual business model. They don't have their operations. It's very capital efficient for them, but at the end of the day, someone's got to do the work. And that's where providers such as ourselves come in, as provider of not only the services, but the value-added services which differentiate the products they'll develop. and the Abzena technologies, as I said before, provide us with the potential to generate milestones and royalty payments into the future. Biopharmaceutical market itself is very significant, $160 billion or more of the revenues within a global pharmaceutical market of about $700 billion come from biologic products. It's growing about 8% a year. Seven of the top 10 drugs in the world today are biologics, so antibody and protein therapeutics. And I said, a lot of companies, whether it be large pharma or biotech, are outsourcing the actual development process. The development, outsourced development services market is $5 billion plus today and continuing to grow. And as we better understand the disease mechanisms, the innovation required to address those, the innovation bar is rising, and that's where we come in to provide those technologies to develop that. And we've got a company with immunology expertise, with oncology expertise, and increasingly we're seeing the convergence of that, understanding that how the immune system can be utilized to tackle cancer, the field of immuno-oncology. And we operate in that space by actually providing immunology services, by providing oncology development services. So we work in that field, which is emerging, where you've got the convergence of that understanding of immunology and oncology. And what we're seeing from our pharma partners, increasingly they're shifting towards biologic products. Roche, nearly 80% of their revenues come from biologics, and we're seeing a shift in the sector for away from small molecules to biologic products. And we're addressing those, and we're working with a majority of major pharma companies as well as many emerging biotech. And there's one name I'll come back to later, Gilead, who are one of the world's biggest biotech companies, biggest pharma companies these days. They're not yet in biologics. I'll come back to that, and you'll see how they're getting into biologics in a moment. So within Abzena, who are we? We've got a very experienced team at board level and at management level. Within the board, we've got people who have significant city experience, guys like Tony Brampton, who's formerly with JP Morgan Cazenove. Ken, Peter, Anker, all CEOs, current or past, of biotech and pharma companies. Nigel Pitchford is Chief Investment Officer at Imperial Innovations, one of our significant investors. I've got a biology background, molecular biology background way back. I'm really a jack of some trades. But in the executive management team, we've got individuals who've developed products all the way through to market, from preclinical development to registration. So we know what our partners are looking for when it comes through to the development. We've also got depth of expertise. Matt Baker founded Antitope. He's a leading immunologist. Our immunology expertise and capability, which I'll come on to, is recommended by the FDA to those who are looking to understand the immunogenicity of their products. Lee Pierce founded and grew Pacific GMP, the manufacturing business we acquired in the autumn in San Diego. She really knows the nuts and bolts of manufacturing using single-use disposable technologies. And Naresh Jain is a chemist who founded TCRS before we acquired it, who'd taken products into development at J&J, and founded TCRS and grown that business. So we've got a very strong team at the executive management level who've got experience within their technology disciplines and the development process. We've been a public company since July 2014. We listed on AIM in July 2014. We raised further capital in December in connection with the acquisition of TCRS. And the funds we've raised are being used to broaden our service offering, doing more of what our partners need to take those better biopharmaceuticals into development, to invest in those technologies, the innovations to bring forward to apply to those programs, and the acquisitions we've made to broaden our offering. Our investors include Imperial Innovations, who are investors in polytherics within the group from many years back, Invesco and Neil Woodford, significant investors, holding close to 50% of the business between them, and Bailey Gifford have increased their stake now to close to 4%. So we're very pleased to have the support of investors like Invesco Woodford, Bailey Gifford, and Imperial Innovations. So the drug development process is long, complex, and uncertain. You all know that, we all know that. To take it through a product through to full regulatory approval and marketing, it takes many years and a lot of capital. What we're doing is enabling that process, as I say, with our research services, where we're paid for the work we do, the immunology service, the immunogenicity assessment, the protein engineering, the bioconjugation, where we're attaching drugs to antibodies to get targeted therapy, and the chemistry solutions that we provide. We get paid for the work we do, but we're also unlocking, we're selling in licenses into those programs, we're selling in to those programs. Our technologies give us a future value, so it's an opportunity. But we work with those programs as they continue into manufacturing, where we produce the manufacturing cell lines. If you're going to produce a protein, it comes from a living cell. You've got to have a well-characterized, stable, high-yielding cell line. We have the cell line development services, which then go through process development into GMP manufacturing. So as I say, we can provide the soup to nuts to take a program from the lab bench into clinical development for our partners. And we're expanding on the manufacturing side, having made those acquisitions in the US in the autumn, expanding the capacity there. There's so much demand, there's limited capacity in the industry to manufacture protein and antibody therapeutics. So the complementary services we provide are listed here, and I won't go through each one of these in details, but there's plenty more information if you're interested in those in particular on our website. But as I say, we're providing those, getting services from the antibody engineering immunogenicity assessment within the antitope business, within polytherics focused on conjugation, within Pacific GMP process development and GMP manufacturing and TCRS on chemistry and antibody drug conjugates. But those services, in some cases, as you can see illustrated here, lead on to the potential for license revenues. And as I say, we're paid right across the business for the work we're doing. But then we're also enabling products to go into clinical development. 11 products in clinical trials. One of those is already in phase three clinical trials, so approaching registration that we've got an economic interest in. So I keep saying about immunology and immunogenicity, what am I really talking about? So anything your body sees is foreign to it, can generate an immune reaction to that. If you're developing a vaccine, that's exactly what you want. You want your body to generate an antibody response to that vaccine. That's the desired effect, that's beneficial effect. If you're developing a therapeutic protein or antibody, you do not want your body to generate antibodies to that product. You'll neutralize its activity. You'll lead to it being eliminated from your body more quickly than is desired. And in the worst case, you'll get a severe allergic reaction to that product. Now, you're going to find that out when you go into clinical trials. When you go into patients, you'll find that out. In some cases, with very significant adverse consequences. You're much better finding that out before you go into the clinic. You avoid wasting money on developing products with limited potential. You avoid putting patients at risk. So you're better off finding out before you go into the clinic. And that's what we do. We have what we call the EpiScreen assay platform. It's been developed over many years, used by the majority of major pharma as part of their selection process for which products they're going to take into development. And the reason they use that is because the data we generate from our EpiScreen platform, where we're taking blood from volunteers, processing that to isolate the relevant white blood cells, processing that and incubating that with our pharma partners' samples to identify, do they have the potential to lead to a T cell proliferation, cytokine release, which is basically a marker for the potential to generate antibody drug antibodies. You identify that preclinically. And our assay, the EpiScreen assay, actually correlates with what's been seen in the clinic. It's rather important, if you're using an assay platform to decide what you take into development, that it will correlate with what you would have seen in the clinic if you'd progressed. And there are a number of products, older products, which have been developed, which do see a high level of clinical immunogenicity. Significant number of patients develop antibodies to these products. Yeah, alemtuzumab, very old antibody product, came out of the pathology department up in Cambridge. Does give benefit to multiple sclerosis patients, but you see a significant percentage of patients generate antibodies to that product, limiting its potential. And we would have seen that in our EpiScreen study, if that had been used before the development started. So we can use that to pick better candidates for development. So what we see is a correlation here between the reported clinical immunogenicity for a range of products and what we see in the lab before you start development. I say pharma companies used it. Craig earlier referred to Novartis' product Cosentyx, recently approved for treatment of psoriasis. Novartis, you can see from the publications, Novartis used our Episcreen platform as part of the development of that product to demonstrate that they will not see immunogenicity of that product as it goes into patients. So we're working with major pharma to enable them to develop better products. I'll just clarify, that's a service offering. We don't have an economic interest in that product. That's purely service. We've not embedded our technologies in that product. However, if you've got an antibody that has that potential to generate anti-drug antibodies, you might want to re-engineer that. You might not have an alternative candidate. You might not have a range of candidates you can choose. You might need to re-engineer that. So the first generation of antibody products, monoclonal antibodies, came from mice. Yeah, this is a mouse antibody. You're all familiar with this kind of Y-shaped structure. This pink represents kind of mouse-like structures. We moved in the industry towards chimeric antibodies, which combined mouse and man to produce that antibody. So you're reducing the amount of the product, which could generate an immune response, because of course it's come from mouse, it's not come from you, it could generate that anti-drug antibody response. And then we've moved to humanized antibodies. Alemtuzumab is a humanized antibody, but it still contains mouse-like sequences, which can generate that anti-drug antibody response. But we've got our own patent-protected composite human antibody platform. We've got granted patents covering this platform, which mean that we can re-engineer using human sequences, which have been shown to be non-immunogenic from the database of sequences we've got. We can re-engineer those antibodies so they won't generate an anti-drug antibody. We won't generate antibodies in an undesirable way when they go into patients. So we avoid immunogenic T-cell epitopes. This is one of our Abzena Inside technology platforms. It gives us Abzena Inside licenses. Moving forward in the development process, manufacturing. As I said before, we acquired a manufacturing business in San Diego back in the autumn. This is Pacific GMP, contract biologics manufacturing business. It's based on single-use disposable technology. It's a fast, flexible approach for the development of a manufacturer of products. What you see in this photo here is the wave technology. It's basically a rocking table with a plastic bag on it in which you culture your cells, and you culture your cells to produce your protein, your antibody. The guy who developed this concept develops it sitting on a plane with an American Airlines tray on his lap and thought, this would be great. Rather than having huge stainless steel tanks and all the capital investment associated with them, the validation, the cleaning associated with them, and the downtime between batches, if you've got a rocking table with a disposable bag that you can use, you've got a flexible, efficient process for manufacturing. So Pacific GMP was built on the use of this technology, and we acquired that business to now give us a broader offering for our partners to be able to continue through that development process, having selected those products, to now manufacture those products for them. Antibodies themselves are great products. They target the relevant cells. They target the circulating ligands to have their activity. But they have limitations, and they can be improved. For cancer cells, if you can target the cancer with an antibody, but attach to it a cytotoxic drug, then you've got a more efficient weapon against cancer. So antibody-drug conjugates are targeted chemotherapy. You're attaching a cytotoxic drug to an antibody to give you an antibody-drug conjugate. So the antibody targets the tumor cell, it's loaded with the cytotoxic drug. After the antibody is taken into the tumor cell, the cytotoxic drug, the chemotherapy, is released, killing the cancer cell. We have our own proprietary technology, and yet another of our technology platforms called Thiobridge technology, which it gives you a more efficient process and a stable process to create that antibody-drug conjugate. And what we've done is taken our platform, Thiobridge, and compared that to a marketed antibody-drug conjugate. So Adcetris is a product that's approved for Hodgkin lymphoma, a product that's developed by Seattle Genetics and marketed by Takeda. And we compared a Thiobridge antibody-drug conjugate using the same antibody and the same cytotoxic drug, compared that to the marketed product. And so over here, you can see this is from a mouse study of a growing tumor. And without any intervention, you see the tumor growing. over up to 40 plus days. What we see with this marketed product, you're seeing some reduction in the growth of that tumour. Using the same antibody, the same drug, same horse, same jockey, different saddle, we've got a better product. So Thiobridge antibody drug conjugate provides a better product because of the stability. You do not want that drug coming off before the antibody drug conjugate hits the tumour. That drug is toxic. You're going to limit the efficacy and increase the side effects associated with any product if you've got the drug coming off. One of the benefits of our Thiobridge technology is the stability and the homogeneity. And so that technology platform, which is developed in-house, we've got granted patents covering that platform. It's led us to conclude a license agreement back in January with a major US biotech company, as I said before, has potential to deliver us $150 million of license fees and royalties on the development of that product. So in terms of our Abzena Inside products, I said there are 11 products in clinical development. These are the ones in clinical development. You see a range of company names listed there and a very wide range of indications that are being progressed. There's no concentration. So there's no disease concentration risk. There's no single partner risk in terms of this platform. We're not funding their development, so there's no investment risk from us. It's just a question of waiting for the return, because we've got an economic interest in all of those products. Whilst we can't confirm the terms of any of the license deals, you know, the leading analysts assume we're going to get around 1% royalty on these leading programs. Analysts also predict that the products here, the named products, have got peak sales over 10 billion. So we've got the potential from these programs, if successful, to generate tens, if not over $100 million of revenue a year as we're generating royalties from those products. Some of the earlier stage programs in phase one we can't name, but you see who they are or what the programs are, but you see some major US biopharma companies here. Can't name them, but I'd just say that three companies have been bought for $1.5 billion. So our sweet spot for working with companies, we start working with emerging biotech companies. They get acquired by pharma because the pharmas see the benefit of continuing the development. They've got their expertise. They've got the capital to develop those products through to registration, whereas an emerging biotech company will struggle to raise the capital, struggle to develop, access all of the expertise to develop and successfully commercialize those products. So we're very happy to start working with a small biotech company and end up with a relationship with a major pharma company. So Dearon until September was a private West Coast US biotech company acquired by Roche for $580 million for one antibody based on one phase one clinical study. So we've got a broad portfolio across a range of indications that you can see up there that we've got an economic interest in, which are progressing. The lead program is in phase three. So Gilead, I said I'll come back to Gilead. Gilead, one of the world leading companies in the sector these days, known for their expertise and their products in the hepatitis field. So liver disease is one of their areas of expertise. Gilead did not have biologic products today, but they did acquire back in December 2010 a company called Aresto. Aresto had two antibodies which were composite human antibodies, Abzena Inside products that they paid $225 million to acquire that company. The lead program of those two antibodies, GS-5745, is being progressed now in a phase three study in gastric cancer patients. It's gone straight into phase three from an ongoing phase one study. The data in gastric cancer patients in that phase one study has led Gilead to advance that straight into a phase three program. So gastric cancer patients where the prognosis is not great have the potential to be better served in the future with this product, which is now in a 430 patient phase three study. But that product is being developed for a range of other indications because it's an anti-MMP9 antibody. So it's implicated in a range of diverse indications. It's being progressed for ulcerative colitis in a combined phase two, phase three study. So it starts off phase two to select the dose and dose regimen and then we'll move straight into phase three. That's a 1,600 patient study that's ongoing. It's being progressed in a phase two study in Crohn's disease, 175 patient study. Rheumatoid arthritis, Gilead have said that they're planning a study in rheumatoid arthritis. And recently in their earnings call also said they're going to be progressing this product in COPD and cystic fibrosis. They're investing a hell of a lot of money in this product. They're confident in that product. That's a product that we've enabled with our technology. It's an Abzena inside product. That's in phase three. Phase two, their second product, simtuzumab, NASH, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, fatty liver disease. A lot of obese patients will progress towards fatty liver disease, will progress to non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, will progress to cirrhosis, will progress to requiring liver transplant. Analysts have forecast that the NASH market could be $20 billion market, and there are currently no approved therapies. Simtuzumab is being developed for NASH in three ongoing phase two studies, but also for primary sclerosing cholangitis, a disease where scar tissue affects liver function. So it's an orphan disease, it's a rare disease, where the only treatment option is liver transplant. And there's a phase two study where we expect the data this year with simtuzumab. Abzena then, switching tack, it's an Irish company, private biotech company. As I said, sweet spot working with emerging biotech companies. But it's a company whose investors include Amgen, Baxalta, the spin-out from Baxter. Roche and Novartis are backing that program for delayed graft function, where a significant percentage of patients who receive a kidney transplant develop or have delayed graft function, so the transplanted kidney is not working initially. So there's a 350-patient study ongoing. MD Anderson saw data in myelodysplastic syndrome animal models and said, we must take this product into a phase two study. So there's an ongoing study, 40-patient study in myelodysplastic syndrome. So that program's in phase two. And then Vascular Pharmaceuticals, a company that's backed by Johnson & Johnson, is progressing their product for diabetic nephropathy, where again, a significant percentage of diabetic subjects will develop diabetic nephropathy. So we've got significant interest in programs which are progressing through later stage clinical trials, which have the potential to deliver to us significant license and royalty revenues into the future. So where are we today? In the 6 months to 30th September, we generated £3.5 million of revenues. That was up 43% on the year before, with service revenues up 47%. The acquisition of Pacific GMP only occurred on the 11th of September, so there's only a very small contribution from the acquired business. So that's essentially on a like-for-like basis, we were growing at 43% in the first half of this year. And TCRS, we only acquired in December. So no impact in the results through to September. We'll see that starting to come through in the year to March. We generate, I provide our services, gross margin between 45 and 50%, so gross profit of 1.6 million. If we were a standalone service business, without the overhead of being a public company, without our R&D investment, we've got a profitable service business. But that would just be a service business, not a service and technology business where we can enable the better products of the future. So we are investing in the technologies, R&D investment, leading us ultimately to being a loss-making company. We're well backed by strong investors, as I've named. We raised money in December. We raised 20 million net of expenses in December, which we spent some of that in acquiring TCRS for $15 million. So we're well funded. We're not investing in development, so we won't have to keep coming back to the market to raise more money. Our business plan takes us to profitability without further fundraising in the absence of any further acquisitions. As you can see, the service revenue split here on the right, you get a lot of revenue from immunology services. That's a lot of revenue coming from big pharma companies. It's a gate opener to the cross-selling of our technologies. We get paid for the work we do in protein engineering conjugation, but interestingly, those are the technologies, the services which give us the license interest in the products of the future. So, delighted to have a business here today, but a business with great potential in terms of generating license revenues in the future. That's the Abzena story, the business, our technologies. Be very happy to take any questions, and if you want more detail on our technologies, refer you to our website as well. Thank you, John.
We have time for one question. Anyone? Okay, dates for the diary. What should we be looking for for the next few months?
So, well, we'll be having our full year results coming out around about June. Then you'll see the impact of the acquisitions we've made on the revenue side. Our partners will be announcing clinical data through the year. We anticipate, I mentioned before, Gilead, PSC study, potentially that will be reading out mid this year, and other programs towards the end of this year. And we're very active on the business development front. We anticipate further licenses for our technologies being secured through this year.
So watch this space. And of course, you're going to be hanging around now, so if people want to ask you questions in the coffee break, they can.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gina.